Hey, it's Blake here. I want to talk to you about what it was like for me as a first-time self-employed homebuyer to buy a house and some of the mistakes that I made. I have bought property before, never bought a house before. I was a renter. I had rented for years. I had recently just paid off a bunch of debt. And I said, you know what? Now is the time to buy a house. And so I go on YouTube and I see all the videos for people who are employees, who have W-2s and how simple it is and yada, 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 who cares? Then I see a few videos for self-employed people, but they're more about just like, here's the documents you need, short, 5-minute videos. And if you want to know the information, I'll write a blog post, I'll link below. But if you want to know like a more personal, story-based experience, where I just kind of talk about it, this is what I'm doing, and it's in lieu of like a live stream or a podcast, just because I'm experimenting with new formats for video, and this is like an actual thing I went through that I think if I talk about with you, it will provide value to your life, especially if you were like I was a year ago when I first started trying to buy a house, and I was kind of lost. There was nobody that I knew that was in the same position as me. There were a lot of people who did, bought houses the regular way, or, someone who maybe owned a business that was bigger, but just not people who were just starting off. And as a result, I made a bunch of mistakes, not mistakes that kept me from buying a house, but mistakes that did delay the process that may have cost me money in the long run, just little things. And so I want to talk about them. And if you have any questions, you can ask them below and I'll do my best to answer them. It is just my experience. I'm not a realtor. I'm not a mortgage officer. I just bought a house. And so we'll talk about this. The first thing I have to kind of explain is, give you context for who I am, where I live, right? So self-employed, live in Michigan. I started looking for a house in 2020, the summer of 2020. And initially, I did not know how much house I wanted, right? So I knew how much I could afford based on the warehouse payments, based on my rent, all that stuff. That isn't how banks do it, really. Banks don't say, oh, you're paying this much, you can have this much for a mortgage. When a bank gives you a loan, it's more based on your income to debt ratio and how much you're paying the government in taxes. So there are a lot of people out there who are self-employed who are like, I only paid $2,000 in taxes because I wrote off everything that I possibly could. And I'm not a tax attorney. I'm not going to say if it's a good idea or a bad idea to do that. What I am going to say is if your AGI, your adjusted gross income, you go down to your tax return and you see all, the profit, basically, the money you pay taxes on. If that's like $6,000, you're never going to get approved for a house. Unfortunately, that's the world we live in where, you have to pay $10,000 a year, a lot more in most cases, in taxes to buy a house. That's how it is. So go back, 2 years. I pay off all this debt. I'm making my money finally. I'm able to like put myself in a position to buy a house, but I don't really know how much house I want. I'm still kind of like paranoid about being behind on payments. Well, I've never been behind on payments. About having debt. And so I don't want to get as much of a house as I can actually afford. I'm looking down, I'm saying, okay, what would give me a life where I never have to worry about paying my mortgage because it's so small compared to the money I make from YouTube or from Amazon or from eBay, all those combined, that it's going to be an afterthought. That's kind of where I was 4 months in. The first 4 months of my house search was me looking at houses that I probably could afford, but we're just like pushing the limits. I'd have to put out a giant down payment to make it work. Or I'd just be stressed out, or I'd have this expensive house and I'd have this warehouse. And so for like 3 months while I move everything, it would just be really stressful for that. And maybe it wouldn't get done correctly. I don't know. It was just a lot of stuff that I wasn't thinking about it from the perspective of what's best for Blake. I was thinking about it from the perspective of like, what's everyone saying around me? Like, what are the people, what's my family saying? What are my friends doing? My family's like, oh, buy the biggest house you can. And I'm seeing my friends, they're married, they've got two income, they're buying giant houses too. For me, just self-employed, you know, no kids, live with my girlfriend, but I'm the one buying the house. And so what it took me a long time to figure out, and this is one of the mistakes I made, is understand like what house works for you. So it took me a long time to figure out exactly how much house what I wanted the most for me. You know, I would have moved way far away, you know, way up in northern Michigan and bought a log cabin on 40 acres and had a big pole barn. But that wouldn't, while that's like nice in the short term, that wouldn't have been like the long-term life that I wanted. It wouldn't have worked for my girlfriend. It just would have been bad. So now that we understand that, or I understood that, I went to get pre-approved for a mortgage. I had already been pre-approved at this point. But like I got pre-approved twice. It took me a year to buy a house. Each pre-approval lasted 4 months. The market was crazy. For the first like 8 months of the year from when I decided to buy a house until when I actually closed on the house, for like the first 6 or 8 months, I was convinced there was going to be a crash, that we were in a bubble. And so even though I was pre-approved, I'm very conservative when it comes to the financial risks I take. So I'm always going to hedge my bets. So even if I think the market might crash, I still wanted to have that pre-approval option out there. Got pre-approved, realized maybe it wasn't doing, you know, totally the best stuff. So I reapplied for pre-approval in 2021 with my 2020 tax documents, because I made more money in 2020 than in 2019. Even though I made more money and I paid more taxes and I had more money in my account, that didn't matter though, because the way I organized my businesses and the way it changed from 19 to 20 was that YouTube was paying entity A in 19 and paying entity B in 20. I owned both entities. It wasn't like it was being laundered or something like that. I mean, obviously it's not, but just some people don't understand what I'm saying, so I have to really break it down for them. What it was is that in 1 year it was paying this LLC, and then I changed the bank account to another LLC because I wanted to separate the businesses. In my mind, not a big deal. In the bank's mind, that was the dumbest thing I could have done, because it took that 3 or 4 years or whatever, how many years it was, of consistent income and erased like a third of it. Now, even though I have the income and I'm making more money, the bank says, well, we can't use this because it's only a year old. And we think that you're actually, Pablo Escobar. And this money from YouTube, well, it's not, you know, it's actually drug money. Or maybe they think, oh, it's not gonna last. Which again, any bit of research would deny that, but that's how it goes. So I get pre-approved for a smaller amount, which really, that's what, okay, you're getting a smaller house. That's what like really confirmed it, because I was like, I don't want to be dealing with this stuff where I don't know and I'm uncertain. So I didn't lower the bar, because the house is still a very nice house. It's still an expensive house. But I just said, this is what like the bare minimum that I need to be happy is. Let's shoot for that. And I was realistic. I didn't like mean the bare minimum like a shed. I mean like, okay, big yard, big garage, close to where I work. That's the bare minimum. 2 bathrooms. That's the bare minimum. Whereas before, I was like giant pole barns, acreage, woods, you know, neighbors, that kind of stuff. I had to throw that out, because not only did I not want to pay for that, after this second round of pre-approvals, I couldn't get a mortgage without a giant down payment, and I wasn't going to do that. So while this is all going on, I'm talking to realtors. And what I really hate about realtors, and what I think you should worry about if you're getting a realtor and you're self-employed, is they don't really, they say they have your best interest in mind. They have a fiduciary obligation or whatever, however it's phrased, but they really don't. You know, there's this thing called plausible deniability, where as long as they can say, I didn't know about that, oh, geez, like you can't sue them or whatever. They have there's no consequences for them. In my opinion, any of these professions that are mandated by regulatory agencies, so like let's say you have to have, an appraiser, you have to have a realtor, you have to have certain certification if you want to be a hairdresser, you have to have certain certification if you want to be an exterminator in some areas. I think all of those jobs are unnecessary for people like me, who we can do our own due diligence. Like the realtors I talked to, they'd say, oh, well, I can, you know, I asked them because they had asked me to sign an exclusive agreement. And I'd say, no, like, why would I do that? What's the benefit to me? And they'd say, well, I can give you information that you don't have access to. When in reality, that information is available for $3 if you do a property search. It's like BAS is like the software that in Washtenaw County or Ypsilanti Township or whatever uses. And you just search it up by address and it costs like $3 or it's even free sometimes. And you can see the taxes. You can see when there was permits pulled. You can see all the information that like Zillow doesn't have. And to take it a step further, and this is information that I actually tested. I would quiz realtors. I'd do my own research first. And then I'd quiz the realtors to see if they actually looked up the stuff. And they would never look it up. One time, I looked at a house in Dundee, Michigan on River Raisin, or the River Raisin, however you say it. And it was in a FEMA flood zone. It wasn't like, you can't build here flood zone, but it's like, every 50 years, this might flood. And I asked him, like, hey, is this going to be dry? Is this like a safe place to be? And he goes, oh, shit, yeah, sure, of course. No, it wasn't. It was not. Like, you clearly can look these FEMA flood maps up and you can see, like, no, it's not going to be okay. And just like my experience with realtors, and I'm not saying they're all bad people. I'm just saying their job is unnecessary for a lot of people. And so they kind of coast on this mandate that you have to use one. And the realtor that I ended up buying the house through, because you basically have to have one, worked with the listing agent. And I talked to him for a total of an hour, probably. And he, you know, didn't teach me anything. He would take credit for, like, suggestions I would make. It was really dumb. Like, the initial contract for the house, and I'm skipping ahead here. I said, I want to make sure it's contingent upon an appraisal, upon an inspection, and upon one more thing. What was it? Appraisal, inspection, and getting a mortgage. Yeah, that was like an obvious one. But just like you want to have ways to get out of it. And meanwhile, when we're closing, he says, oh, yeah, I did this for you. I made sure we had all these things. And I said, what are you talking about? I told you to put these things in there. You didn't tell me to put these things in there. But that's just the mentality that they have. They think that because they're licensed, it's some crazy, difficult skill to understand how to negotiate, which is just not the case at all. For a lot of people, they're great. I'm just saying from my experience, what these realtors offered me was nothing. And they just tried to tie me down to use their services. When you're self-employed, maybe the realtor is 40 miles that way because you're looking at a house 40 miles that way. But you're also looking at a house 40 miles that way. Is this realtor you signed an exclusive agreement with, are they really going to drive 3 hours, you know, or an hour and a half there, an hour and a half back, 3 hours total to show you a house? No, they're not. There were times when I tried that. Before I signed the agreement, which I never signed at all, and they'd say, oh, the listing agent, they're not seeing the house. You know, someone put an offer in. And then I'd call the listing agent, and they'd say, yeah, sure, come on by. And it was just put a really bad taste in my mouth with just the lies they would tell me to try and expedite buying a house that was beneficial for them, you know, to get their commission. That's not how they all are, but I'm just saying, like, that really bothered me a lot. So we ended up just talking to the listing agents, and I did this. I don't think this would work in most, you know, for every house that's been sold. Generally, it makes the most sense to have your own agent who's going to negotiate for you. But I can negotiate for myself, and I did negotiate for myself pretty effectively. That paired with the fact that the demand was so high for houses that I thought that by contacting the listing agent, because they get a larger commission, it would incentivize them to accept my offer or incentivize them to persuade the buyer or the seller to accept my offer. Is that the best advice for you? I don't know, but I think it worked out for me. So we're fast forwarding until 2021 when I'm doing the second round of looking at houses, and I look at 10 houses, put offering on a few. None of it really works out. You know, some houses are too far away. Some houses, you know, maybe they have things that I don't necessarily want to take care of, too big of a yard or a bad neighborhood or just little things like that. Or there's 10 offers in and I wasn't willing to go above asking price because for me, this was not a house I was going to live in for 50 years. I hope I live that long. Not a house I'm going to live in for even 10 years, probably. I'm probably going to be out of this house in like 5 years. And so for me, rather than like, oh, the perfect home, it was very important that I find a house that will go up in value you know, predict it'll go up in value as best you can. Obviously, markets are volatile. But it was very important to me to find a house in a good neighborhood with a large population center where this house didn't have any damage, but because it was not updated in certain ways, was considerably cheaper than the houses that sold around it. And so we're looking at houses. A lot of the houses are just garbage. And they have water damage, or they have mold, or they have crooked floors, or they have, you know, cracks in the ceiling. And the listing agent says, oh, well, the seller didn't disclose this stuff, which is just bullshit. You know, it's just plausible deniability. The house that I ended up buying, I called the seller out because in the disclosure form, they said, oh, a disclosure form is a form that they have to sign saying what's wrong with the house and other stuff like that. She said, no lead. I didn't know if it has lead paint. They didn't know. Then I hear her talking to someone. And she said, oh, yeah, my family's lived here since the house was built. How does someone who has had the house the whole length of the house not know if it's lead-based paint? How is that possible? And it was just, they were just lying. They were liars. I know they were liars because later on through our negotiations, I offered to buy all of the furniture out of the house. Everything in the house, not just the furniture. I specifically said, I'll buy everything in the house for $1,000 if it makes you leave sooner. And they agreed to that. And then I drive by the next day and they're having a garage sale. So at that point, I was almost ready to pull the offer off the table because I do not like being lied to like that. But I said, okay, you know what? I'll just take a picture of this, take a video. I'll show the realtor and I'll say, offer's off the table, $1,000. I'll still buy the house. Because at that point, we had already, you know, agreed to that I was going to sell the house. And I signed an offer letter. So I was already in for that. I had my contingencies. We'll go into in a second. But I didn't want to just buy their leftovers for $1,000. And they were trying to pull a fast one on me. And I don't like that. But luckily, you know, I had these contingencies in the offer. And what contingencies are, basically, like I said earlier, it was mortgage, inspection, and appraisal, right? That's what I said. And this is, I think, where I did not make a mistake. I think a lot of people make mistakes here, but I didn't make a mistake in that I was extremely assertive in my negotiating tactics. The house was listed. I'm not going to give the price or the location because I don't want to go to jail for shooting a home invader trying to rob me. But I offered about 95% of asking price. It was on the market for a week. And then after they accepted that offer of about 95% asking price, I ended up taking off another about 15-20% because of issues with the inspection. The roof was old. There were cracks in the facade. The carpet had to get pulled up. There was a lot of little stuff like that, that after they accepted my initial offer with these contingencies, I came at them in order to pressure them into lowering the price even more. And I think that there are a lot of people out there, especially who are my age and a bit younger, who are uncomfortable with that kind of assertive negotiation. But you have to remember, these people are not there to help you out. They're trying to get as much money as they can from you while giving as little as possible. That was proven to me with the whole garage sale fiasco. So you have to have no sympathy, no empathy, none of that bullshit for these people. They are your opponents. Now, if you have enough money, where you can just, oh, sure, take 10 grand. Oh, sure, take 20 grand. Whatever, ignore me. But for the most of us, it is a war. They're not going to say it like that, but it really is. And so I send them my list of things wrong with the house, itemized with how much money I'm not going to pay, how much they have to take off. And they counter and they, you know, posture and try and buffalo. But eventually I said, okay, like, listen, you don't have to pay for it all, but we're going to have some sort of compromise. And they ended up taking about 10% off of, no, less than that, 9% or 8% off of the house, they didn't take it off, okay? That's where I was kind of confused too. They didn't take it off. They used it towards the down payment. So I thought it was going to be they pay me a check or just I pay them less with my overall mortgage. But in order to keep the value of the house high, in order for the realtors to get a larger commission, they don't actually lower the sale price, or at least in my case, they didn't. They just paid part of the down payment. And so that was really, really nice because I ended up saving a whole bunch of money that would have gone to the down payment that I could then use to do things like, repaint the house, change the interior, get my car fixed, buy some tools, buy some furniture, get the roof repaired, all that stuff. Stuff that money that could have gone to the down payment, but just having them pay it kind of like forced my hand into paying for these repairs, which is fine. You know, it's fine. Better to be forced to do repairs, I think, than to have your house cave in on you. So we closed on the house. It took about, 40 minutes, signed a bunch of documents. It was very awkward. I closed in the same room as the seller, and like they were behind this plexiglass wall because of health protocols. And she was like crying because they were old and they had sold off little parcels of their family used to own the whole block, and they sold off bit by bit by bit. I assume because of poor financial decisions. I have no idea why you would do that unless you needed the money, but that's what they did. And they were like the last people to leave. They were going down to this like, little condo they have in Florida. And so she was trying to be like, very like, oh, woe is me. Which I did not understand that at all. I think, you know, we agreed to this transaction. I thought it was kind of pitiful behavior, but that's how it was. And so I had to deal with that. Very, very awkward. What I have heard after the fact from telling this story is that most times you close separately, I guess, to avoid things like this. But in my case, I got to look face to face with these ungrateful elderly people who, I don't know. I mean, they were mad that I didn't pay for their furniture after they tried to rip me off. They were mad that I wouldn't buy a 30-year-old roof. All this stuff that's just, like, ridiculous to expect someone to do. And that just, like, really, like, nails home what I'm saying earlier is that even if they're trying to guilt you into paying for things that you shouldn't pay for, don't listen to them, right? They don't have your best interest in mind. They have their best interest in mind. You are your own agent, your own negotiator. And if you're self-employed, I think this really, really has to hit home for you, because like when you run your own business, who else is negotiating for you? You think, eBay cares? You think USPS cares about your business? No, not at all. And in the same way, they don't care. The realtors don't really care. The home sellers don't really care. And that wasn't a mistake I made, but it's a mistake I can see a lot of people making. And so if you're listening to this and you're going to buy a house, I'll just sum it up like this. Number one, buy a cheaper house than you can afford. If it's your first house, make it as cheap as possible and then build it up to what you want. Number two, make sure you've got more than 2 years of stable income sources. Number three, do as little as you can with realtors unless there's a good reason to use one. Because if you're self-employed, you already can do most of the stuff that they do. I mean, I get they have to do the closing paperwork and that kind of stuff, but if you really want to, you can just hire a lawyer. You can just hire a title company. You can do that stuff on your own. You don't have to go through a realtor. They make it seem like you do, but you really don't. And I guess the last thing I would say to you is negotiate ruthlessly, right? Negotiate like your life depends on it, because this is your life. This is your livelihood. Don't get pushed into taking a bad deal because you see your friends buying houses, or your family says to buy one, or the family selling it, you know, tells you a sob story. None of that stuff matters. What matters is your own personal happiness of yours and your family, whoever's living in the house, and it's your obligation to pursue that with the utmost energy. Hope you guys like the video. I hope you guys enjoy this kind of conversation. And if you have any more topics you want me to talk about, please put them below and I'll do that. See you later.